जय दोस्तों, लेट्स बिगिन विद द डेली न्यूज एनालिसिस। इन द फर्स्ट आर्टिकल, सुप्रीम कोर्ट रिफ्यूज टू ऑर्डर द रिलीज ऑफ रोहिंग्यास। इन दिस आर्टिकल यू विल गेट दिस सम ऑफ द फ्यू फंडामेंटल राइट्स मेंशन इन द आर्टिकल दैट आर एप्लीकेबल टू द बोथ फॉरेनर्स एज वेल एज सिटीजंस। सो आई हैव मेंशन अ लिस्ट ऑफ फंडामेंटल राइट्स दैट आर एप्लीकेबल टू सिटीजन ऑफ इंडिया एज वेल एज द फॉरेनर्स। द फर्स्ट इज द आर्टिकल 14। आर्टिकल 14 सेज दैट इट इज अ it is right to equality, that is equality before law and equal protection of law. Similarly, article 20, that is protection in respect to the conviction of offenses. Article 21, article 21A and article 22. Similarly, 24, 25, 26, 27 and 28. These are the few articles of the fundamental rights that are applicable to both citizen as well as foreign citizens. In detail, we are going to study in the polity classes. Next, there are some few fundamental rights that are exclusively only for the citizens of India. That is Article 15. The Article 15 states that it is a prohibition of discrimination on the ground of race, religion, caste, sex, and place of birth. And Article 16 says that is equality of opportunities in the matter of public employment. And most important, that is Article 19. Here, the Article 19, here it has six rights. First, it is a right to speech and expression. Next, right to assemble peacefully without arms, to form an association or union, and to move freely throughout the territory of India, and to reside and settle in any part of the territory of India, and to practice any profession or to carry any occupation and trade or business. As article that is A, B, C, D, E, F, there are multiple. In order to remember, in short, just consider a person who needs to speak out and to express his views. Then if he expresses, then similar related ideologies, people assemble peacefully without arms. Then if they assemble, then they form association and union. If they form association, then they move from one territory to another territory. And when they move from one to another, then they reside in that part of the territory. And from there, they can practice any profession. So in this way, in a chain system, you can remember the articles that are in Article 19. Next, Article 29, that is protection of language, script and culture of the minorities. And in India, there are six minorities, that is Muslim, Jews, Christian, Sikhs, Parsi. I think I'm missing one out. Try to find it in Google. Next, Article 30, that is right of minorities to establish and administer the educational institution. These are the few fundamental rights that are only applicable to the citizen of India. In the next article, that is Archaeological Survey of India will survey the mosque orders the Varanasi court. Here, the important part is what is ASI, whether it is a constitutional body or statutory body or independent body, where its headquarters, and these all we can get it from here. That is, the Archaeological Survey of India is attached under the Ministry of Culture of Government of India. And the important here is it comes under the Ministry of Culture. Next, it is a statutory body. The statutory body means it is the body which is framed in the parliament by means of legislative procedure is known as statutory body. Next, ASI is headed by the Director General and his headquarters is in Delhi. The main function is the preservation, conservation and environmental development of centrally protected monuments and sites, including World Heritage Monuments and Antiquities. Next, it has a publication, that is, it publicizes the Ancient India, Epigraphia Indica and Indian Archaeology, a review. These are the some few important points related to the Archaeological Survey of India. Next is the editorial article, in which the article stresses on net zero carbon emission. As yesterday, one article was there regarding the net zero carbon emission. So you must understand the sequence in the editorial or any information related to the current affairs. If any one information comes in the newspaper, then day by day, the same article will be repeated with different information. So you have to read continuously the Hindu newspaper so that you can get multiple views and multiple ideas and multiple points regarding a single topic. So here, the net zero, first we'll try to understand what you mean by net zero. The net zero refers to the reaching net zero carbon emission by selecting a date under which any emission from any source is balanced by absorbing an equivalent amount of emission from the atmosphere. Like, for example, if a carbon is emitted from a vehicle for example, then that amount of carbon has to be absorbed by other means, like planting so and so many trees, so that these plants can absorb the emitted carbon. So the net emission of the carbon at last will be zero. Next, in this article, they are trying to stress regarding on climate change and its impact on the smaller countries. Here, the article particularly mentions that the climate change is the biggest crisis, and also it has impacted more on smaller countries, including the island nations, by intense storm, lost farm productivity, drought, heat wave linked to the climate change. So the India's contributes to the problem with its total annual emission. It is surprising, therefore, that the clamor is growing for India to join many other countries and commit itself to the net zero carbon emission. Also, USA is pursuing major green technology initiatives in post Donald Trump era, which means USA is willing to transfer the green technologies to the developing and underdeveloped countries if they opt for net zero carbon emission. Also, it is a duty of the biggest or more developed countries like USA, UK, the Europe, and other who occupy the bulk of world's carbon budget to give up the further emission in favor of developing countries and fund the transition. Here, main important point is, at the peak of COVID-19 last year, the center, that is the India, have seen to go ahead with the liberalizing the environmental clearance and also extending the deadlines of the coal plants to adopt the strict pollution control. The intention of doing such is to promote the growth, promote the industrialization in the areas so that it provides employment during the times of economic depression and recession. Also, here we have to understand the consequences of net zero carbon emission. As India is a developing country, it is lacking in infrastructure, it is lacking in poverty, because in India more than millions are starving, they are not getting adequate amount of food, malnutrition is a major problem. So India should concentrate first on these areas, and later on they should think of net zero carbon emission. If India prioritize the net zero carbon emission, then the India's development may be hampered in future. So from this article you can get the knowledge related to the net carbon emission and its impact on India and how it is impacting the smaller islands. In the next article, the author is trying to say regarding the impact of agriculture, its balance of power, diversifying the public procurement, and also ensuring a steady market. So the author is trying to say that after the post-economic, that is the liberalization, that is economic policies, the globally, that is 1991, the importance to the agriculture has been reducing day by day. Also, the agriculture importance and its uncertainty of the weather to the soil fertility and water availability is increasing. Returns to scale are very difficult to achieve in the farming. Also, the production process in the agriculture cannot be organized in an assembly line as in the industrial process, as most of the farmers harvest their crop at the very same time. Almost 86% of the farmers are small and marginal farmers. So they come all together, all the farmers, they compile to bring their harvest to the market at the same time. Since the demand for the food crop is typically price inelastic due to the bumper crop, because if it is a bumper crop, then there will be drastic fall in the price. And if there is a drought, then there is a rise in the price. So for a poor consumer, it is a threat. It is a threat because they are unable to pay the high price for increased food crops, which were earlier cheaper. And also it may result in starving or being forced to buy the very expensive commodities and conveniently hoarded, which are conveniently hoarded by the traders. Here you can take the best example of onion. During non-season, the onion price will be around 10 to 15 rupees. If there is a shortage of supply, then the price increases from 10 to 100 and 250 rupees. So here in the agriculture, the power, that is the main power, is controlled by the moneylender. Here, when you compare the moneylender with the current condition with the past, here the moneylender combines the role of input supplier, crop buyer, labor employer, as well as land lesser. Because of that, he is holding major part of the power in dealing with the agriculture commodities in the market. That has resulted in oppressive to the lower caste farmers facing a cumulative and cascading spiral of exploitation. In the diversifying the public procurement, as the government of India under Food Corporation of India and also Agriculture Price Commission, here the government is concentrating on few crops. What we have seen in the Green Revolution is that farmers are assured that their surplus will be brought by the government at a price high enough to live at a margin. Here, the crops procured are made available to the consumer at a subsidized price through public distribution system. Here, what has happened is the government has selected few crops, and that has resulted into favoring that crops by the farmer. This has resulted in growing a water intensive crops, and that has resulted in steady decline in the water tables and water quality. Also, the increase in productivity has promoted the use of expensive chemical fertilizers, which has contaminated the 90% of waters with what the farmers are consuming. Here, the author is trying to say that the author is trying to stress that the government has to expand the basket of public procurement to include more crops and more regions and more farmers. If it is done in a right way, then this single reform would be having multiple win-win situation. That is, it will be having higher output, it will be having more sustainable for the farmer, greater water security, and better consumer health. Thus, along with that, the government also ensures a steady market. Like under the Pradhan Mantri Annadata Aaya Sanrakshan Abhiyan, that government is trying to procure the food crops through public distribution system. The author suggests that a locally procured crops should be incorporated into Anganwadis, supplementary nutritions, and schools' midday meal program. This will be having two advantages. The farmers will be selling their product in the locally, and also the product sold will be used locally itself. Here, the transportation cost as well as the various warehousing cost will be saved. Here, along with that, the India's main challenges, that is the malnutrition and diabetics, can be solved easily. Also, the current India's network is having 2,477 mandis, but it, according to the geography as well as the population, it requires around 42,000 mandis. So the government has to work regarding increasing the mandis to the higher, like every year it has to increase at a suitable rate so that most of the farmers are covered under it. Also, with the pace of development and urbanization, the recent United States estimates that in the year 2050, around 800 million people will continue to live in the rural India. This gives the uniqueness in the Indian demographic transition, and agriculture will need a steady strengthening as well as steady growth in the near future. So agriculture can only be reformed by radically enhancing the state capacity and qualitatively better regulatory oversights, rather than by opening up the space for more predatory action by all those already entrenched in the position of overwhelming power in the economy. So this article mostly covers the overall condition, what the current condition, what are the consequences of past decisions taken by the government, and also suggested few measures so that they can solve the current challenges what the agriculture is facing. The next article here, it is explaining, like the author is trying to explain the Pakistan's flip-flop on the trade with India. Here the author says that on March 31st, Pakistan's finance minister has said that Pakistan's economic coordination and committee have decided to import cotton, yarn, and 5 lakh metric ton of sugar from India. And the media dubbed it as a political breakthrough that the Pakistan is willing to have a talk with India and also willing to trade with the India. But on the other hand, due to the multi-power nation, the Pakistan's prime minister, its general, as well as its foreign ministers are giving statements that it is not on par to start the trade with India, and also they are sticking with some preconditioning requirement that has to be fulfilled from the India. So basically we have to understand why the Pakistan is in need of importing of goods from India. First and foremost, Pakistan's cotton production has been decreased more than 50%, and as most of the Pakistan's industries, that is textile industries, are exporting the finished goods to the European nation and US, so it needs the raw material like cotton to feed the industries. Next, also there has been a increase in the sugar price, so in order to reduce the sugar price, Pakistan needs to import the sugar from India. And you may be thinking that why Pakistan is trying to import from India itself? They can import it from other country also, but in terms of economy, in terms of suitability, in terms of demand, India is best in terms of all these conditions to import the goods to the Pakistan. So by looking into the benefits of the Pakistan's trader as well as industries, India is the best India is in best condition to import the goods to the Pakistan. And also here the Pakistan is taking a U-turn where its supremacy of politics overtakes the trade and economy, where the politics claim is supreme over trade and economy. Thus, and also again and again taking up the issues of Jammu and Kashmir, Pakistan is hampering its relation with its neighboring countries, and also that have costed both India and Pakistan in terms of trade. But when it compares to the impact on Pakistan, it is deeper and larger when compared to the India. So from this article we can get what is the condition of the Pakistan, why it needs to import the goods, and it is just by means to fulfill the needs of Pakistan and not to start any talks and trade with India. Next, one map based question, that is we can start today with the South China Sea, as it is in current affairs, that is it is in hot news regarding the South China Sea, like what it is, how many countries are surrounding it, and what are the consequences, why all the countries are fighting over South China Sea. Basically, the South China Sea is an arm of the Western Pacific Ocean in the Southeast Asia. It is south of China, east and south of Vietnam, west of Philippines, and north of the island Borneo. The border states and territories, that is, if you go in clockwise, the first is the China, next the Taiwan, Philippines, Malaysia, Borneo, Indonesia, Singapore, and Vietnam. It has a connection with the Taiwan Strait, with the East China Sea, and by Luzon Strait with the Philippine Sea. So it contains numerical shoals, reefs, atolls, and islands. That these are all corals, and the Paracel Islands and the Spratly Islands are important, and it is a issue of dispute with these islands only. Also, what makes it so important, as so many nations are fighting for these islands? First and the foremost, this sea has a tremendous strategic importance, because more than 80% of the trade of oil, that is crude oil, which takes place through Malacca Strait, passes through the South China Sea. And also the United Nations Trade and Development says that 1/3 of the global shipping passes through this, because this is the gateway to the China, Japan, as well as Russia. Along with that, according to the Department of Environment and Natural Science, Natural Resources, in the Philippines, it says that 1/3 of the entire world's marine biodiversity and a lucrative fisheries provides a food security to the southeastern nations. Also, there has been in news regarding a huge oil and gas reserves beneath its seabed. Because of that, multiple nations are fighting for these disputed areas. So this covers the whole news of today's The Hindu. Keep revising, and if you want a detailed information regarding the recent incident in the Myanmar coup, you can watch a video which is in description. You can see it. Thank you.
जोश है हम में जान है और उमंगे है दिल में जवान क्या कहे तुमसे दोस्तों कि अब तो जाना है हमको कहां मैं उनको रोज